I've sculpted this character in Mudbox, starting from the base mesh. And I begin by using my grab and my wax brushes to distort the shape of the character's silhouette so that I take it from the default Mudbox base mesh and I turn it into something that more closely matches the shape that I'm looking for. So I'm using the wax brush and the grab brush very liberally in the beginning to add volume in the areas where I need it, to cut away areas where I want to remove volume. And in some cases, I'll use a sharp negative brush, in this case the foamy brush, to start to cut in sharper details. So edges around the mouth, shapes in the cheeks and around the eyes, shapes in the nose, and between the wax brush and the foamy brush, the sharp negative brush, I start to lay out the basic shape that I'm looking for. Once I feel comfortable with the base shape laid out, that's when I start to subdivide my mesh to allow me to create extra detail into this shape. So I start with a very low res shape. I deform that low res shape using the wax and the grab brushes as we saw a moment ago. And once I'm happy with the base shape, it's only then that I move on to actually starting to add a little bit more detail. And I iteratively add that detail throughout the entire process. And in cases, I'm starting to add details such as the eyes now, and I can see that the mesh is, it looks very aliased. There's lots of triangulation. This is an indicator of when it's time to subdivide to add more detail to my mesh. I'm trying to create detail, but it shows up pixelated or triangulated or aliased. That means that the level of sculpt detail I'm working at isn't sufficient for the level of detail I want to carve into the mesh. That's when I can start to up-res my model. And once I've up-res the model, then I start focusing on creating tinier details, again using a sharp brush like that foamy, or in some cases using the pinch brush, as I'm using now, to pull points together to create sharper creases between existing areas of detail. The eyeball area is definitely an area that we focus a lot of attention on because our viewer is going to focus a lot of their attention there. And creating proper eyelid shape can be difficult, so I like to actually create an eyeball shape that I can fit into the eye socket and help guide me in my placement of the eyelids. I've created a new sphere just inside Mudbox, and now I'm repositioning it and scaling it so that it fits into the eye socket area, and that will guide me. Now I'll be able to use that to create more accurate detail around the eyelid area. And speaking of detail, now I'm going to start adding wrinkle and muscle detail to the face. I'm using a brush that has a very sharp fall off and a negative value to carve those shapes into the face. And I also use a pinch brush at the ends of these wrinkles so that the wrinkles taper to a very fine point. And this pinch, this taper at the end, is very important for creating the sense that these wrinkles or these shapes are actually fitting into the geometry of the face. I also use the wax brush. As we'll see, I emphasize around the edges of various wrinkles, build up around them, and then smooth that wax into the surrounding area. Now, we're looking at lots of fine detail, but at some points we'll want to go back and change the very shape of the object itself. In this case, I want to change the shape of the jaw. And I'm using the grab brush to do that, and you'll see that I've stepped down to a very low level of detail. It's easier to make changes that affect the entire mesh at the lower levels of detail than it would be to make at the higher levels of detail. So when I want to make those big structural changes, I'll step down to a low resolution, make those changes, and then step back upwards to process those changes and to use my detail brushes like the foamy and the pinch to start to cut into the mesh and to kind of ground those details. And we see in this case the details that I'm adding are kind of like wrinkles or stretch marks over the musculature in the back of the neck and the shoulder area. And I'm just cutting those in using that sharp negative foamy brush. And I'll blend the edges in on one side of that crease, and I'll leave it as is on the other side of the crease so that we get kind of a sharp contrast in one area and then a smooth contrast in the other area. And that gives that stretched skin feeling that I'm looking for. And throughout the process, I'm switching between the low res and the high res, making structural changes to the shape of my object on the low res, and then adding fine level of detail on the higher subdivision levels of my mesh. So a good example is coming up where I'm going to start making changes to the ear. And so there will be structural changes that I need to make to the shape of the ear, so the exterior silhouette and the overall position of the ear. Those will be done at a lower subdivision level. And then I'll use higher subdivision levels to start to carve in the actual form on the shape of the ears. So the outer lobe and the interior structures on that ear happen at middle levels. And then when it's time to really sharpen that detail and create much sharper edging and creasing, those happen at much higher levels of subdivision. So while I'm adding fine detail, we'll see that the camera is very close on my subject. But in a moment, I pull out here so that I can make changes to the overall shape of the ear using a more broad view. Now we'll see that I'm repeating the line process that I used in the cheeks. I'm using a sharp brush to carve in some lines in the forehead region, smoothing out some other areas so we get a nice fine blend between our shapes and it feels like a cohesive whole. And I also use the wax brush again to kind of overlap these sharp lines that I've created. This gives the sense that we've got bulges of skin that are creating these fine lines, and it's not just some lines that we've etched on the surface of our object. So I'll use a lot of different lines in different areas to just add surface detail to the shape of my model. And when it comes to surface detail, at a certain point we reach the limit of what we can do with just sculpting, and it becomes much easier to use our spray or our repeat brushes to add detail to the surface of our object. So I'm adding something that looks sort of like pores using my spray brush. And anytime I'm doing fine detail like this, I have it on its own sculpt layer to make it much easier to manage. And we'll see that I spray it on, and then I can control the opacity or the strength of that effect by simply adjusting the sculpt layer. So we see that as I'm applying the spray brush here, the effect is very overwhelming. It just overpowers a lot of the sculpt detail on the model. But when I reduce that sculpt layer to a strength of 8, now I end up with something that's much more usable. And as a final part of the process, now I'm using my grab brush to go in and start to create asymmetry on the shape of my model. So we always want to have a less than perfect symmetry on the shape of our characters to create a more organic feel. So the grab brush allows me to move shapes very quickly to break that symmetry, and then I can go in and add a little bit more detail. Use that grab brush to create bigger changes, so repositioning the eyes, the ears, the nose, so that we get rid of that symmetrical detail. And all of this is happening on its own sculpt layer. And this means that I can always turn that sculpt layer off and then go back and make structural changes that will affect both sides of my model. Because once I've added asymmetry to my model, there's no going back. I won't be able to use symmetrical changes anymore, especially if I've changed the location of key features such as the eyelid and the edges of the nose. So having that asymmetry on its own layer is extremely useful if I have to go back and make changes for whatever reason. And we see that just adding a scar over the top of the one eye is a bit of fine detail. And to integrate that into the surface, you know, I lay it in fairly heavily using the wax brush, but then I go in and I use my sharp-edged brushes and my smooth and my pinch tools to integrate that shape into the surface of my mesh. So we don't want it to stick out as if it's a separate shape. We want to work extra hard to show how it blends in to the overall shape of the mesh so that it feels like it's a cohesive whole, instead of just being something that I slapped on at the top at the last minute. And at this point, the sculpt is basically finished. I'll make last tweaks to the high-res skin detail layers, the pores and the skin surface. So here's the final result. I've enabled ambient occlusion in the viewport to really help those fine details pop on our sculpt.